morning. How wonderful to see you all. Everyone who comes in from now on must sit on this side of the church. Today we're talking about, continuing actually, our discussion about gratitude. And so I want to share with you Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your work to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. Please stand and join us as you're able in our opening song. From Pennington, New Jersey to my town, Appleton, Wisconsin. And not long after she arrived, my dad said, "You will be going to visit your great Aunt Grace every Sunday afternoon. You will be cleaning her apartment and you will be doing her laundry." In exchange for that, my great Aunt Grace, who I just called Aunt Grace, gave me a dollar. And she made me this lunch that I never ever would have gotten at home. It was especially for me. She found out exactly the foods I liked, and she had at least one of everything every Sunday. And more than that, she told me what it was like to be born in 1899. She told me the stories of the legacy of our family. And most of all, she loved me in a way really no one ever had. Somehow she thought I was this amazing eighth grader, when, you know, eighth graders are pretty dorky and we don't really necessarily have a lot of friends, but all of a sudden I had this nearly 80-year-old woman who thought I was the cat's meow in every way. As we sing this next song, Live Like That, I invite you to think about the people in your life who have loved you in that unique and special way, the way God loves you, and how you might pass that love on, that legacy of love that makes people feel whole and blessed, and that really is a representation of what God does for us. I invite you to sing with us, Live Like That.
I didn't put on my microphone before the service, self-confession. You may be seated. Welcome to worship. My name is Gary Holmes, and a little bit lost here this morning. But it's great to welcome you in worship. We continue our focus on gratitude. And I pray that as we go through this, we'll get a sense of how that motivates and guides and directs us, that the purpose of God just lives through the abundance of our willingness to be thankful. And so we're going to take a moment. First of all, be thankful that you're here today. And so the ushers will hand out a connection card. That's important for us to connect with you and support you. Those of you online, what a blessing to have you in worship with us today as well. If you take a moment to let us know of your presence, that's appreciated. So we'll continue our work and service together. And we're going to take a moment now just to get a little greeting from Pastor Andrew.
Hey friends, the Bible tells us a story about 10 lepers. Lepers were people who were sick. They had a disease that everyone could see. And because of their disease, they couldn't be a part of the community. Jesus healed all 10. He changed their lives. Because they were healed, they could go back to be with their families. They could be a part of the community that they knew and loved. But only one of the 10 came back to say thank you to Jesus. Do we say thank you to God when we are thankful for something that we have or something that God has done? It's important that we show our thanks to God. So at this time, I want to help some of our kids catch up on their thank you notes.
Dear God, thank you for my baby brother. But if you'll recall, I think I asked for a dog. Dear God, thank you for making light. I'm sorry that Thomas Edison guy gets credit most of the time. Dear God, thank you for Wednesday Night Live. Now my dad doesn't have to cook so much. Dear God, thank you for helping me when I'm scared at night, and for my teddy bear and nightlight too. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who shows us how to love each other, even people who give us homework.
We want to take this time to say thank you to God. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we thank you for all of the good things that we have in our lives. Help us to show our gratitude to you by loving others. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
My gratitude. Pray with me. Loving God, we come before you with hearts overflowing with gratitude for the countless blessings you have bestowed upon us. In the midst of life's challenges and uncertainties, we are reminded of your unwavering love and faithfulness. Thank you for your provision, your protection, and your presence in our lives. We are grateful for the gift of peace that surpasses all understanding, a peace that anchors our souls in the midst of storms and calms our fears. Help us to rest in your peace, knowing that you are sovereign and that your plans for us are good. We pray now the prayer requests that are on our hearts.
Lord, we offer prayers for elderly parents experiencing changes. Prayers of joy and for guidance in the rebirth for our church. Prayers for the family of Dixie Dixon, whose celebration of life was yesterday. And also we lift up Pat and Bernice Kissinger on the death of their sister and daughter, Pam. And finally, prayers of healing for Mike Storr, who fell and broke his leg. Lord, these are the prayers of your people.
Holy God, may your peace reign in our hearts, in our homes, and in our world. Use us as instruments of your peace, spreading love, kindness, and compassion wherever we go. Help us to be peacemakers in our relationships, seeking reconciliation and understanding, even in the midst of conflict. We pray for those in the Middle East, the Ukraine, and those anywhere in this world who are struggling with fear, anxiety, or unrest. Pour out your peace upon them and surround them with your comforting presence. Bring healing to broken hearts, restoration to weary souls, and hope to those who are despairing. In the midst of the chaos of this world, may your peace be a beacon of hope and a source of strength for all who seek refuge in you. Help us to trust in your promises and to walk in faith, knowing that you are with us every step of the way. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And now we offer this prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'd like to share a song this morning that speaks really loudly to me every time I hear sermons or any talks about gratitude. This song comes to the forefront of my mind. It's by my favorite, Ken Miedema. But it tells of different times in life when he has been grateful. And I have experiences myself in each one of these. And every time I sing it, I think about those. So I would like to invite you as you read the words and as you hear the song, to enter into your own prayer of gratitude for these times in your life.
Thank you, Sue. The power of that song is just knowing that Camino is blind, and so much of his imagery is what he hears. And what a blessing reminder to us today. overflowing generosity. Can we get enough of this? Well, we're going to a little bit more. Gratitude sees at the very foundation of our lives, in all circumstances, this foundational stability. It's faith that runs really deep. And the things that are shallow that seem to disrupt us don't have their way. Because we know in the power of generosity and our connection with the divine, we have this incredible health benefit, physical, mental, and spiritual, that guides us. We talked about celebrating what's right in the world with DeWitt Jones and the National Geographic. And as a photographer, he has asked to celebrate what is right in the world, because rather than wallowing in what is wrong, there's plenty of that opportunity. But he calls us to, our vision controls our perception. And our perception becomes our reality. Our vision controls the perception, and our perception controls our reality. Do we choose the possibilities? Do we choose the lens in which we see life of a celebration? Because in choosing gratitude and gratefulness, we can live into response that God desires for us. Gratitude does express itself in the way that we are generous with our lives, our all of our resources, and many of you received, as a part of the life of this congregation, a letter encouraging you to consider how you can support the life of the church. There's just no way around that. That's how we do ministry. But I'm excited because I see so much happening around us that gets me encouraged, and I see light and hope and promise, and I pray that we're motivated in ways that we can honor God through our generosity. There was once three individuals, and they were together, and one was a lawyer, one's a doctor, and one's a pastor, of course. And they're all boasting about their generosity. In fact, the first, the lawyer, says, I once gave away half of my wealth to charity. Not to be outdone, the doctor chimed in, well, I once performed free surgeries for an entire month. I don't know what that would do, Hoy, if that happened or not. But anyway, and Ben, then the pastor, not to be outdone as well, smiled and said, that's well, all and good. But I once gave a sermon on generosity and was so inspiring, half the congregation emptied their pockets. Well, our effort and our commitment to inspiration and generosity is different. My hope today is that we're confined to this sense of, what can I be? How can I live? What do I do with all that I have to honor God and be generous? So let's gain an insight as we look at our first scripture lesson today. And it comes from 2 Corinthians. And here's an area of the region. It's written to the church of Corinth, which you know is at the bottom of Greece. And it also references churches in Macedonia, which is in northern Greece. And these churches didn't have quite the wealth that the Church of Corinth, being in a major center of commerce that was going on. And he's trying to write to the church to encourage them to understand the blessings, the wealth that can come to them. So we're going to take a look now at 2 Corinthians chapter 8, the first 15 verses, and I'm going to throw a little bit of Gary commentary in there, so bear with me as we go through it. Brothers and sisters, we want to let you know about the grace of God that was given to the churches of Macedonia. While they're being tested by many problems, their extra amount of happiness and their extreme poverty resulted in a surplus of rich generosity. Now that's a strange formula, isn't it? Happiness, extreme poverty, rich generosity. I assure you that they gave what they could afford, and even more than they could afford, and they did it with voluntarily. They urgently begged us for the privilege of sharing. What's wrong with these people, right? And the service for the saints. They even exceeded our expectations because they gave themselves to the Lord first and to us, consistent with God's will. As a result, we challenged Titus to finish this work of grace with you the way he had started it. So we're talking about Macedonia so far. And it's this impoverished nation, that impoverished area, that gave out of gratitude. They wouldn't be denied the opportunity. Verse 7, speaking to the church. But the best in this work of grace, in the same way that you are the best in everything, such as faith and speech, knowledge, total commitment, and the love we inspired in you. Church of Corinth, I'm not giving an order, but by mentioning the commitment of others, the Macedonian churches, I'm trying to prove the authenticity of your love also. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Although he was rich, he became poor for your sakes, so that you could become rich through his poverty. I'm giving you my opinion about this. Interesting, Paul would slip that in. I'm giving you my opinion about this. It's to your advantage to do this, since you not only started to do it the last year, but you wanted to do it too. Now finish the job as well, so that you finish it with as much enthusiasm as you started, given that you given what you can afford. A gift is appreciated because of what a person can afford, not because of what a person can afford, if it's apparent that it's done willingly. It isn't that we want others to have financial ease and you financial difficulties, but it's a matter of equity, equality. At the present moment, your surplus can fill their debt, so that in the future, their surplus can fill your debt. In this way, there is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered more didn't have too much, and the one who gathered less didn't have too little. May God bless the hearing, reading, and understanding of this scripture. That last phrase is written from Exodus, a quote, where the people are kind of frustrated in the wilderness as they're heading towards the promised land, and they're saying, we're better off back where we were. This is really difficult. In the midst of that, God provides manna and quail. And the giving of manna, they're trying to figure out, what is this stuff? In the midst of that, they were given the opportunity to go and collect what they needed. And it's interesting that they said that they gathered more. Those who gathered more didn't have too much, and those who gathered less didn't have too little. This sense of God's provision, this sense of equity, even though it's not always the same, and we could try to make life all the same, but we can strive for equity at allowing people to have their needs met. And so that's the blessing that we have, that God's provision is enough and how we share it. Collecting for the believers in Jerusalem, those who were struggling, facing a lot of hardships, was the motivation for Paul running to the church of Corinth, providing them for improved support, demonstrating solidarity within these different communities for the care and concern of each other. This generosity was a way for the love of God just to expand and find expression. Generosity at its center. So here we're dealing with the church and churches in Macedonia, and we know that there is a willingness that was beyond their means. They were constantly looking for opportunity. Their generosity was happening even in the midst of affliction. And their eagerness to participate just couldn't be stopped. We want to be generous and give to the needs of others. So we have this sense of the Macedonian churches give beyond their means. Give beyond their means. They were marked by joy in the midst of poverty. I don't know, if you've ever been around individuals who even might experience poverty, sometimes you experience a joy that you just don't get. How does this make sense? And I remember when our church, previous church, I went on a mission to Guatemala, and I think those some of you have gone to Guatemala from this church as well, and we are aligning with a new mission agency. We are a new church, and we're looking for opportunity. We wanted to make connections, and so we went to Guatemala, and I can remember the gentleman and I as we went there, and boy, it was the first international trip we had ever done. We went to airport, and we were the only white guys around, and it was, for us, a little intimidating. We were the minority. Get a glimpse, right? Finally, we were caught by those who were going to work with us. It was a pastor who had children adopted from Guatemala, and he started a clinic and a food program. It's just amazing, and they were just getting started, and we were one of the first to go with them, and it was just a beautiful experience. But it was amazing as we got to know the people and listen to them and then experience life with them, the joy they had, one of the more impoverished areas in the world, and there just seemed to be happiness. This sense of being able to contribute and to give comes out of even in poverty for the church of Macedonia. The sense of grace that surrounds us and the scarcity is overcome by the abundance of support and care. We also have to be mindful. Remember, just a few weeks ago, we read out of Luke where Jesus is mentioning the woman who had given out of her poverty the coins into the offering. But just prior to that, she reminded the leaders that those who are leading in the life of the church, they are the ones who cheated widows out of their homes. And to show off, they say long prayers. They will be judged most harshly. There's a responsibility to each other. We care for each other. And the intent is to create a poverty for everyone, but give opportunity for those to have, to give what they can in the moments they can. Not always financially, sometimes in other ways of service and care and compassion. That's the economy of the life of the church. So the Macedonian churches gave beyond their means. But Paul's writing to the church at Corinth. And this church gave in proportion to their abundance. The Corinthian church gave in proportion to their abundance. The churches in Corinth were characterized by a desire to excel in giving, but they didn't give out of small means. They got out of a sense of abundance. This leads to understanding the importance of what it means to find opportunity in situations in which we can honor God. So often I think the church of Corinth gets the bad on this text, and it's just pointing to the churches of Macedonia giving. But I think Paul's still trying to encourage them that in the economy of life, there's not equity in that sense. The equity comes in our willingness to give out of what we have. And I think maybe most of us today are connecting more with the church of Corinth. And how might we honor God in the way we give? We started out well, and the challenge is for us to live into that. What are the opportunities we have to make a difference? How can we, out of a sense of abundance, allow the ministry of hope and love to happen? This week was kind of a special week because I was hearing witnesses to people who are so blessed by the ministries and life of this church. In fact, we had a story of someone who was sharing about an experience that they had come to this church and how their family loves coming especially to the Wednesday nights, the opportunity to have a dinner and to socialize, to have an opportunity that the children love to come to experience life and ministry. How they love the classes which they come to that focuses them in on their parenting skills and the relationship with their spouse, all these things. And they would never make the time to enhance those relationships except what was given by the church. They're so thankful and express gratitude for what's going on. You know, when the church lives into its possibilities, it's amazing how attitudes of gratitude and the sense of overflowing experience and gratefulness can be transformative. Sense the movement, the opportunity. From the gospel reading, this morning we go to Luke chapter 6, verse 28. Give, and it will be given to you a good portion, packed down, firmly shaken and overflowing, will fall into your lap. The portion you give will determine the portion you receive in return. This writing in the sermon that Jesus is giving is just reminding us that the economy of God's grace is that giving graciously also gives a return. Now, here's the challenge. Some interpret this as, wealth in giving. This sense that if I give so much, God will return it. So it almost becomes a financial plan that I'm going to improve my well-being by giving more to others, so God has to give me more back. I don't know how authentic that is. Because most of the gospels challenge us to give what we have, and there's the beauty we have. I think it's a description. It's taking an example of how they would prepare seeds to share, and they'd be generous. They pack it down, they give it, deliver it, and that's the opportunity. And the return is a benefit. The return isn't always financial. The return is an opportunity to live into the nature of God's kingdom, that generosity abides. We find the sense that the text has this layered meaning of generosity and giving. Jesus begins instructing how we followers can give. This is not only for money, but this expression of one's time and resources and love. It makes all the difference. It's a call to selflessness with our generosity. There's a reciprocity also in field here that Jesus describes. This reciprocal thing of when we give, we receive, and implies that giving generously, that the opportunity, that the abundance, that we can experience it. There's a sense of the measure of giving, that we give proportion of what we have, that honor can happen. Again, this sense of shaking it down and shaken together and added until it's overflowing. What a vision and understanding that we are given. So often we find ourselves trying to collect, and we do. We try to be responsible for our willingness to gain an income, to save appropriately, to give generously, and to take care of daily living is all a part of it. But sometimes our expectation that we just collect so much, and reminded in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount when he says, "Stop collecting treasures for your own benefit on earth, where moth and rust eat them and where thieves break in and steal them. Instead, collect treasures for yourself in heaven, where moth and rust cannot eat them and that thieves don't break in and steal them." How do we attribute to the generosity of God's love? By investing in the kingdom, taking opportunities we have, proportionally giving to the care and support of others. It's life transformational. It's centered in who we are as beings of God's children. It's aware of the divine economy of caring for those in need, and somehow God provides for us in the same. It's almost an attitude that we bring into our generosity. Do it willingly and with pleasure. The churches in Macedonia, they couldn't be stopped in giving generously to those in need in Jerusalem. The power and the blessing of this text. It's surrounded by quite a bit when you look at the Luke chapter 6, and Jesus is instructing his disciples how to be teachers in that context. And he calls them to see Jesus and to follow him, to hear and understand, to live the gospel out in the way they do. And he's challenging to make sure that it's not like the blind leading the blind. So there's a clear indication that generosity is at the heart of what it means to follow God. Makes me think about the challenges of the church today and how as a pastor, or a clergy, we are to teach and to lead and to understand. We have 3 years of seminary and other training, pastoral care, theology, all the things that help us to be faithful to that. But the reality is that we're still all growing. And I think there's great challenge when those who are proclaiming and teaching come across like there's no weaknesses. And it seems like the worst time for any community of faith to move is to entrust themselves into one who's teaching without any question, reflection of their own. That we're responsible. And I think in this area, Jesus is just challenging us to be aware of that. That we begin, and it reminds us, even when I'm proclaiming and I'm working through and I'm trying to grow my understanding, that I do it with humility. That there's a sense of vulnerability. And when someone leads in the church without vulnerability, I get nervous. Amen? Because there's sometimes this sense of, I'm in control here. And let's just be clear, I'm not in control here. And by the grace of God, you have hope because of that, right? My role is support and equip and draw attention to God's grace and have you hear and listen to connect with God relationally and those around you, to grow in your understanding, be reflective, be a life learner, and to serve in ways of ministry and service into the life of the world. We're all a part of that. And isn't it neat to know that the economy of God, in our weakness, God can find strength. And we draw ourselves closer to the hope we share in Christ. There's a powerful reminder in this text of the importance of generosity for our lives. When I was thinking about that experience in Guatemala, they were just starting that mission event, and we were going to get connected. We were a new church, and we just wanted to make a relationship that was meaningful. And we had given to things like Heifer International, which was wonderful to give animals to communities, but we didn't, other than we knew it was a goat, we didn't know where it went, right? And there's this real disconnect relationally. But then when we found out that we can make a relationship and connect with it, what a difference it made. And it was almost like we were the churches of Macedonia, because in Indiana, there's a lot of wealthy and strong churches, and they could give to that event. But the pastor was looking to our church in Wisconsin because we were one of the strongest givers. And we gave. And for us, that first year, we gave $6,000, which is huge for our experience. We gave what we could. And then we started forming relationships with the ministry. And we'd actually, because they were in the same time zone, we did a kind of a FaceTime with the missionaries there that were working, serving, as they led us in worship. It was just a beautiful thing. And we would travel down there, and then we even had them come up, this relationship building. I was reminded that this church made an effort. Well, this church does mission all the time everywhere. It's beautiful. But I know there's a specific one in Ghana where they put in a well and made a relationship there and be transformable. And the joy that came from that, you couldn't stop this church from giving. In fact, they had enough. They continued on and even gave to build a library. This is the beauty of generosity and the opportunities that we have. And my prayer is that we can continue to be the church marked by our generosity and how we serve each other and serve in mission of the world. Let's make a difference in the way that we live. As we move forward, may God give us the grace and strength that we can have a sense of generosity and connection, that we can honor God in the way we live and the way we give. What's the new thing God is calling us to do? Church leadership is working so hard improving our vision and clarity and understanding who we are in the context of a changing culture, sharing an unchanging truth. The God of grace and mercy is there to heal and to let us know true aliveness, to empower us to overcome the poverty, to allow us to overcome the injustices, to be agents of God's grace. There's a reason to be excited. And may God be honored in the way we become generous and overflowing with our thankfulness and our generosity. Let us pray. Holy God, may we find in ourselves the opportunity to overflow with generosity, to see situations where sometimes it's with our time, our energy, or relationship building, connecting with others. And then there's times for opportunity to share of our resources, proportionally of our income. God, that your grace and mercy can abide and we can make a difference in the world. Be honored in the expressions of our faith. And may this church, may we continue to grow and develop and become aware and encourage each other in how we can make a difference in the needs of the world, that we'd have the courage to move forward, that we remain authentic in our faith, our strength, our weaknesses, and all that we are, so that your gracious love can abound and your strength and your peace might be known. We pray this in the name of our living Christ. Amen. One of the blessings we've had is just being able to hear stories. And one of those today we get to hear is from Hoi Zhang, who's going to share a little bit about his witness in life.
Thank you for that message of generosity, Pastor Gary. Good morning. My name is Hoi Zhang. My wife, Kristen, and I have three young kids, Taylor, Sam, and Katie, and we are fairly new members of this church. They say home is where the heart is. The concept of home has been quite fluid for us in the past few years as we have moved around quite a bit in our lives, especially recently. I was born in China, but grew up in Michigan. Kristen also grew up in Michigan, but in our children's short lifespan, we have moved from Michigan to Pennsylvania to Minnesota and finally here to Whitefish Bay. Throughout all of our moves, we have always craved a sense of belonging and home. Because of somewhat nomadic lifestyle lately, we've learned that creating a sense of belonging and home often starts with our own family unit and using our love for each other to transform wherever we're physically located to feel like our home base. But often, we still felt a longing for a deeper connection with the community and our neighbors. Sometimes this was easy, other times it was challenging. We had a similar craving for connection when we moved here to Whitefish Bay about 2 years ago. Thankfully, we found this church. From the moment we stepped foot in the door, the whole church community welcomed us with open arms and helped us feel like we were truly part of the church family. I remember Beth and the whole hospitality team going out of their way to make us feel welcome. We originally picked this church due to location. We can walk here and from our house, and you often, though, will see our bikes along the fence in the back, and the fact that the Vacation Bible School program started a week after we moved. What a great quick way to join the community. We continued attending and quickly joined because of the people. We were immediately welcomed by many members of the church and felt included. Over the past 2 years, we have gotten to know several other families that have children similar ages to ours. We all know that it takes a village to raise a family, and certainly easier to parent alongside other Christian parents. Connecting with other parents, especially on Wednesday evenings, is often a highlight of our week. Sharing our highs and lows, working through difficult situations together, to know that your child isn't the only one doing a certain behavior, it's comforting to, and definitely helps us be better parents. We are so glad that our children have the opportunity to grow up with the church family. To know that they have other adults who are always looking out for them, to know that they have something to look forward to on Wednesdays and Sundays, to know that they will build friendships that will last for years to come. We look around here at Whitefish Bay and this church and see families that have been here for decades. They are ingrained within the community, and both the families and the communities are better for it. We hope that this is the start of a similar journey for our family. The United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay has played such a huge role in helping us feel truly at home here and has helped us feel rooted in our home. We're so thankful for this community, and that's why we are excited to be part of this stewardship campaign. We want to share our time and financial contributions to help continue the tremendous work that the church is doing in its effort to love God, care for each other, and serve the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Hoy. What a blessing. Now we come to a time where we share a proportion of our income that God could be honored and people blessed, and we learn the blessing of God's generosity being revealed in our own lives. Now we invite the ushers to wait upon us.
Mercy.
One of those opportunities to make a difference, to share our time and energy around something that makes a difference, is to be advocates for those in need. And that's what this next video is, a reminder, and draws us into the opportunities we have to make a difference in our community.
One in four children under five are severely malnourished, but it doesn't have to be that way. You can help today. I'm inviting you, your church, and your community to participate in Bread for the World's offering of letters, a powerful tool to organize letter writing events encouraging members of Congress to end hunger. Simply writing a letter may not seem like much, but I assure you, every voice matters. With your help, we can reach the people with the power and resources to make hunger a problem of the past. Join me by going to bread.org/OL to get started today, and thank you.
My name is Ross Workman, and I'm the chair of the church and society team here at Whitefish Bay. This is our fourth year that we have partnered with Bread for the World to confront the tragedy of hunger in our world. We hope you will join us today by sharing your concerns with our representatives in Washington. On your way out of the sanctuary today, please just pick up a packet which includes a sample letter that you can use and envelopes that are already addressed to our senators. For those of you who are watching online today, you can just, as the video said, just go to bread.org/OL and tap Take Action for an email link that you can also use. There are many ways that we can fight hunger in our world and in our church, from volunteering with a meal program to signing up for Feed My Starving Children to simply writing a letter to Congress. Every act is important, and every act will be blessed by God. Thank you.
Thank you, Ross. Thank you for the church and society team that guides us and helps and reminds us of our connection with the needs of the community. And to know that, like the Church of Macedonia, there's different things we can do, and being generous and writing to our representatives is one of those ways. I'm going to go back, Jacob, just to remember, Ross mentioned it, but we have some things that are coming up next week. We are going to do Grateful Living, Honoring God with Gratitude, and it's going to center around a service that happens on Sunday morning at 10 only. Sunday morning next week at 10 only, because it's our youth children's musicals incorporated into the worship, the Star Factor. Very excited about that. That's happening both Saturday at 5 and also 10 o'clock next Sunday morning. So it'll be incorporated into our worship experience. Looking forward to the children sharing with us. And after each of those services becomes the support for the youth mission trip, the chili dinner. So please remember that. Following that, the way to support the kids in their trip to Nashville, please consider how you can support it. And I got a feeling I'll eat a lot of chili that weekend. Also coming up is Feed My Starving Children, of course. Just a great opportunity to get involved, to be active. Actually, it's a fun atmosphere of joy and celebration that we can put together all these meals to bring nutrition to kids so desperately in need. And you'll learn more about how those meals meet the needs. One of the things when I was in Guatemala that was just such a blessing is when we were working in the food program, we looked over in the corner and guess what we saw boxes of? Feed My Starving Children packages. It reaches kids in need, and it's such a celebration to have. At this time, I'd like to invite you, as you're able, to please stand to receive the blessing. May the Holy Spirit be upon you, reminding you of your sacred worth and your call to be generous with what God has given you and the abundance that all God has for us. Be witness of grace and mercy. Go in the peace of Christ this day. Amen.